So as I told you, the show must go on, and it is really my pleasure to welcome the two distinguished guests who are trying to make you understand that why it's important to use laser microscopy in research and how can it be possible to join, combine living tissue to the high tech. And I have the pleasure that I've been in very good contact with Professor Kellermayer, who is Professor Chairman of the Lamelis University. He is head of the Department of Medical or Biophysics, similar to my job. And Miklós is a very well known scientist all over the world. And he's been using high-tech microscopy and advanced imaging techniques to get information about muscle physiology, but not only. So I hope that the crowd will be a little bit bigger. I don't know where the other people are, hopefully not sick. Feel free to ask questions and make comments, because we are happy to answer.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's my great pleasure of giving this talk to you this morning. And I also would like to stress to be feel free to ask any questions, because we encourage live discussion. So don't resist your temptation if you have any questions to ask. So I was kind of given the title to how lasers can be utilized in muscle research. And I'd like to begin with an advertisement. It's advertisement. I'm going to read it to you. I know this is a week, but I think it's worth the to read it now. This was a few decades ago, in fact, by Dr. Wilkie for a lecture, so that lecture announcement in London. So, available now. Linear motor, rugged and dependable, design optimized by worldwide field testing over an extended period. All models offer the kind of fuel size energy conversion and will run on a wide range of commonly available fuels. Low standby power, but can be switched within milliseconds to as much as 1 kilowatts per kilogram. It's peak and dry number. Multiple construction and wide range of available settlements permit tailor-made solutions, otherwise intractable and mechanical problems. So we have two control systems. The first one is an externally triggered mode. Versatile general purpose units, digitally controlled by picojoule pulses. Despite low input energy level, very high signal to noise ratio. Energy amplification approximately 1 million fold. Mechanical characteristics 170 modules, maximum speed optional between 0.1 and 100 millimeters per second. Stress generated 2 to 5 times 10 to the 5th newtons per square meter. The other control system is an autonomous mode with integral oscillators, especially suitable for pumping applications. Modules available with frequency and mechanical impedance, appropriate for solids and slurries. You can find out what that is. Liquids, and here are the frequencies too. Lifetime is 2.6 times 10 to the 9th power operations in a lifetime. And gases can be also transmitted by this control. Many options, built-in servo, maximum velocity, fine control is required, direct piping of oxygen, thermal generation, and so forth. And it is also good to eat. So you can find out that this lecture was about muscle. So in my talk, I'd like to touch a little bit on what muscle is, what does it do, into two main sections, the active contractility and then the passive mechanics, and then touch on what kind of laser applications might be useful for us, to optical tweezers, mainly with a focus on stretching elastic molecules, mainly the nanomechanics, type giant muscle protein, titanium. So I think this lecture on application of lasers to muscle could not be in a better place in 110 seconds, because in fact the muscle research, muscle biochemistry, muscle biology, muscle biophysics started in Szeged in the first half of the 20th century. Of course it was in the laboratory of Edward Senior, which is just less than half a block away, just a few rooms away in fact. And he was in his laboratory, was acting molecules covered by Professor Straub, and this is where the so-called actinizing superprecipitation was actually first characterized. This was the probably first model which could recapitulate the essential features of muscle contraction, that it was in fact a contractile phenomenon. And I'd like to mention just a few other names, Hungarian names who are quite famous, have become quite famous in muscle research. Andrew Szentgyörgyi, who's a nephew of Bert Szentgyörgyi, Janusz Gergely, passed away unfortunately just last year, Kate and Mihai Bayer, and then Ferenc Luba, also his name is tied to Szeged. Who knows that he was in Szeged? Anyone? He was in fact in the Department of Biochemistry, passed away less than 10 years ago. So, just a few brief notes about muscle, types of muscle. We can distinguish between a few types of muscle cells, cardiac myocyte, smooth muscle cell, myoepithelial cell, and skeletal muscle fiber. And the muscle fibers are long, multinuclear cells, which are composing our skeletal muscles. This is by mass, this is the largest amount of tissue in our in the human body. And the heart muscle cells are composed of cardiomyocytes. These are the smooth muscle cells, which actually can be found in most of our intestinal and other similar types of tissues. And the myoepithelial cells are found in secretory tissues. Most of what I'm going to talk about will apply to striated muscle, which applies to skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle. Just a few notes about these. The skeletal muscle, here we see a big muscle bubble, and these are fascicles wrapped around bundles of muscle fibers. And this is a fiber itself. This is a single cell. This is such a cell. For example, in your sartorius, the muscle can be almost a single cell as long as half a meter. And this is truly amazing. This forms a very special developmental process that results in the formation of such a multinucleated cell. Here we see a fluorescence microscopic image. These blue dots are the nuclei of the cell. And within the muscle fiber, we see these so-called myofibrils. We can purify them, in fact. This is just purified myofibrils. And the most prominent feature that you can see on them is that they have carry cross striations. So dark and light bands and repeats along the axis of these myofibrils. They are able to contract, well, autonomously, meaning that under certain biochemical conditions, if you supply them with calcium and ATP, then even under in vitro conditions, they are able to contract, this is a special type of oscillatory contraction. Nevertheless, you get the idea that they are able to contract, and in fact, these are very popular, these have become very popular items to study the contractile mechanisms. The unit, which lies at the very heart of this repeat. A very repeated arrangement is the so-called sarcomere. This comes from the Greek word sarcos, meat, and of course mere, mera is a meat unit, so it's a unit of meat. Sarcomere is a structural and functional unit of contraction, that's how we band so-called for its anisotropic properties in the polarizing microscope. In between neighboring A bands, so this is the edge of another A band, we find the so-called I band, and within the I band, we find a special set of parallel lined filaments. This is the so-called thin filament, which contains mostly actin and some lining proteins, mostly the gas and regulatory apparatus, troponin, tropomyosin, and this very special large protein called nebulin. Within the A band, we find thick filaments, myosin containing thick filaments, and I already would like to call your attention to a special type of molecule. It's called titin. We'll talk about this a little later. This spring-like feature is, of course, not the structure of the molecule itself. It just points out that we think of titin as a spring-like, as a molecule with a spring-like function. Okay. You can already intuitively come to a conclusion that the contraction of muscle comes about by the translation of the thin filament along the thick filament, and it happens because of this mirror symmetry which happens on both sides, and that results in contraction and shortening of the sarcomere. The heart muscle has a very, very similar composition, and except for the fact that the underlying structure elements of the heart tissue, cardiac tissue, are similar cells. So it's a uninuclear cells. They are also capable of the whole cell is capable of autonomous repeated contraction and force generation. This cell is actually contracting on an elastic surface, and by the wrinkling of this elastic surface, you can see that actually some force is generated by the contraction of a single cardiac myocyte. But otherwise, the as far as the sarcomere construction is concerned, it's very, very similar, except for a few things which are not important for our discussion at the moment. Some basic phenomena of muscle contraction I'd like to share with you. First of all, if you apply to a skeletal muscle fiber or muscle piece of muscle, you excite it with electrical stimulus. A twitch occurs, it's a rapid contraction and relaxation. And if you increase the frequency of the stimuli, you reach a sort of partial tetanus. And then if you reach beyond the frequency, stimulus frequency, beyond the sort of fusion frequency, we reach a sort of complete tetanus. And this is during complete tetanus, the force that generated during this process is considered to be maximum force that can be exerted by the given muscle tissue. So a few more phenomena. Types of contraction. Isometric contraction happens under such a conditions that the length of the muscle is limited and constant. And isotonic contraction is the contraction during which the tone, that is the force of the muscle, is constant. You can achieve that by placing a constant weight, given weight at the end of the muscle tissue, and you allow it to contract. And once this tension is reached, this weight is constant. And while the muscle is shortening, this period is called the isotonic contraction. Calculate the work and the power of generated by muscle contraction, and we can plot it in the so-called force velocity diagram, and of course force times velocity gives the power of muscle contraction. We typically find this hyperbolic curve or function describing the relationship between force and velocity at zero load. When there is no load of the muscle, it contracts with the maximum shortening velocity, this is Dmax, and of course this is the Fmax, which is during which there is no essential visible contraction, microscopic contraction, so V is zero. Nevertheless, under tetanic conditions, we obtain this maximum force. And of course, the area under the curve will give us the power. And we reach maximum power at approximately 30% of Vmax. So So this is just, as you know, it's a rule of thumb. If you like to bike, usually we like to set the gears such that you reach 30% of the maximum speed with which you can pedal. Under those conditions, you will obtain the maximum power out from your muscle. Now, what are the mechanisms of muscle contractions, and what are the questions that prevail? It's a phenomenologically, actually more than half a century ago, so-called silent filament theory was put forth, and these are the three most important persons who contributed to this: Andrew Huxley, Gene Hansen, and Hugh Huxley. The essential features in this are the following. As I already mentioned, the two main filament sets, the thick filament and the thin filament, that is, the myosin-containing thick filament and the actin-containing thin filament, interact, and then in such a way that a pulling force arises, and this pulling force will pull the opposite from the opposite directions, the thin filaments towards the center of the sarcomere, and this is sliding. Filaments slide past one another. And what is more important, however, is that depending on the overlap between these two filament types, we find a very interesting relationship between the tension generated and this overlap, the size of the overlap. Obviously, the size of the overlap will vary with the sarcomere length. The longer the sarcomere length, the smaller will be the overlap, and vice versa. So in this regime, this is number one, this is no overlap, very long sarcomere length, roughly 3.6 microns. If you allow the muscle to contract, or allow it to shorten to smaller sarcomere length, this is number two here, we find this will be maximum overlap, and within this region, we find this more or less linear relationship between the tension generated and the sarcomere length. And what it's hypothesized, although not fully known, that under physiological conditions, skeletal muscles operate along this sarcomere length. Okay? But of course, I must stress that even though we know quite a bit about muscle, and you know, many hypotheses have been put forth decades ago about this function, we still do not exactly know the in vivo sarcomere distribution. So as I speak here, I don't know what the exact values of my biceps muscle sarcomere length would be. So some in vivo imaging would be handy to read this question. And of course, if you go even further, if you allow the muscle to contract even further, there will be some steric constraint towards further contraction as the and the stick filaments bump into the Z lines, so the no further contraction will produce tension. Some of the molecular basis of what is standing behind this contractility, this is the interaction between actin and myosin. This is an active filament, this is a pH around filament structure. The half pitch of this long is 37 nanometers. Diameter of this filament is about 7 nanometers. You can label them with fluorophores and even grow them in vivo. And they have structural polarity, and they have bending rigidity, which is their total persistence length, which actually scales with the bending stiffness of this filament is a few micrometers in length. Of course, the motor, as we currently think of, is the myosin 2 molecule. The myosin 2 is another serial number. This is actually given to this molecule because it has two heads. So it has a two-headed myosin molecule. It's a rough shape. This molecule is in the long tail-like region, and it has the operating end is end terminal, and we have this is the motor. This is the part where the motor function is generated. So there are actually several protein molecules forming this large molecule. There are two heavy chains running along here. So this is one heavy chain, the motor is running along one heavy chain. And there are two times two light chains also associated with it, and it is likely to actually play a role in regulating the contractile property of the Mysin molecule. The crystal structure of the Mysin motor domain was actually published in 1994, and much has been even since then learned about that. We have several regions along this structure. The XP binding, this is where the ATP is bound. At the other end, other side of this head, is find the XP binding site. This is where the Mysin molecule binds to actin and finds converted domain, which actually converts the relatively small conformational changes in this motor domain into a fairly large lever movement that results in contractility. Very importantly, this Mysin motor is a so-called non-processing motor, meaning that it is unable to continuously move along the active formant. It tends to just bind to it very briefly and then dissociate from it. And only under conditions where many Mysin heads are able to interact continuously with the active filament, under those conditions we have continuous motility. And this circumstance is given by the arrangement of these Mysin molecules into these so-called thick filaments, where many Mysin heads line up so as to interact with the same active filament. Why is Mysin important to pathology? We already know that there are many mutations in the Mysin motor domain which result in cardiomyopathies. Many of these mutations have already been characterized, and particularly Mysin mutations lead very often to so-called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, during which the muscle mass in the heart is increased. And this particular example is from a mutation in which an arginine was mutated into Now, functional, the work of detail lies in a cyclic action by these Mysin molecules. This is the sort of Crossley cycle in which we find four main stages. Of course, there are many kinetically, you can identify many more intermediates. The point is that we can start from this intermediate, for example. This is called the writer state. On the binding of ATP, there's a dissociation, and then there is a conformational change within the Mysin head, and then the cleavage of the ATP into ATP and phosphate, and the dissociation of the products of this hydrolysis will actually lead to a contractile interaction between these two filament types, and which results in the force generating step. And Professor Moller will give much more insight into this process. There are certain model, experimental and structural functional models of muscle contraction, and an important experimental model is the in vitro motility assay, in which you can actually use purified protein molecules layered on a microscope cover slip. Mysin sticks to the cover strip, you can add fluorescent actin filaments, and you can image upon the addition of ATP, you can visualize the motion of these actin filaments. This is a real-time recording of these fluorescent actin filaments moving past the Mysin molecules. You can visualize it with regular fluorescent microscopy or turf microscopy. And of course, the structural functional model that had been put forth a few years ago. This relies on structural knowledge of the Mysin and actin molecules. And as you can see, the various steps of ATP binding and hydrolysis linked, coupled to the site interaction between the two filament types, will result in a motion of the actin filament past Mysin. So this, in a nutshell, is an introduction to the active contractility of muscle, and let me just share with you a few ideas about the passing mechanics. Of course, muscle doesn't only contract, but it has elasticity. So if you pull your muscles, there is an elastic resistance which they exert. And the, I already mentioned to you briefly that there is a very important protein called titin that is responsible for the generation of this passive elasticity. And just to already give you a hint what why it is important on the microscopic scale, of course, just consider the fact I already mentioned to you the slide equivalent hypothesis, which implies, which predicts that the greater the overlap between the thin filaments and the thick filaments, the greater force that will be generated. So if, for example, there's a slight asymmetry of the A band within the sarcomere, the eventually, in the next contraction, the A band might be pulled towards the direction of the greater overlap. So it will be a positive feedback mechanism leading to a catastrophe, leading towards the sidetracking of the A band to one end of the sarcomere. However, if you have elastic components here, that would actually center the A band within the sarcomere. Of course, this is only one of the physiological functions of titin. We keep learning much about this molecule and currently we think of it as a blueprint for the muscle sarcomere. So, just to introduce you to that a little bit further, so upon contraction, this spring actually contracts, and if you pull on the sarcomere, it will extend. And this titin molecule runs from the one edge of the sarcomere, from the Z line, all the way to the M line. And it's a very highly modular protein with approximately 300 globular domains, which are something like this, that can be partitioned into either immunoglobulin or fibronectin type groups. And in interspersed between them, you sometimes find these random or unstructured domains. Very importantly, towards the N-terminus, you find a so-called kinase domain. And this, so far as we know this today, it's a mechanically activated kinase, and we think of it as it plays a role in sensing how much the muscle sarcomere is stretched. So it kind of senses the stretch status of the sarcomere. So it's like a sensor function. Okay, so the titin is interacts with a huge number, dozens of protein partners. Some of them actually diffuse into the nucleus. So this is, we think of it as it actually sends some signals towards the nucleus, and this is most likely the signal is actually relevant for the contractile status on the sarcomere. There's only one gene, titin gene in the human genome. It's a huge molecule. It's a nearly four megadalton molecule. It's the largest protein. It's a world champion in the world of proteins. And the single gene has an amazing number of nucleotide pairs, and 363 exons are utilized. Build up the gene actually, and after heavy electronic splicing, the molecule is expressed. And there are certain titinopathies that actually emerge because of certain mutations. Most of the mutations of titin are thought to be lethal. Titin can be actually elasticity can be modulated. So we think of it as an elastic element, as a template, it's also a mechanical sensor, and it can be regulated by phosphorylation and alternative splicing. Very interestingly, just some final notes about titin. There happens to be a diffusible pool of titin within the sarcoplasm, in the cytoplasm of the muscle cell. This is a fairly new discovery. So far, we haven't really known how titin gets into this place. So, in the sarcomere, imagine the sarcomere, one end of the huge molecule is at one end of the sarcomere, and the other end of the molecule, a chain like molecule, is in the center of the sarcomere. How in the world does it get into its place? It's very, we don't know yet, actually. It was a new discovery that there happens to be a diffusible pool of titin inside the sarcoplasm, which exchanges with the sarcomere pool on the time scale of a few hours. Still, it's a mystery how it's being done. teachers, as you are, you know, probably by now, having gone through the first half of this summer school, you probably know much more about lasers than I do. So lasers, of course, is light amplification process. It's a relaxation from the excited state, accompanied by emission, and of course, there are certain conditions that need to be met. First of all, of course, we need to place the medium into a radiated environment, but beyond that, we need to generate by pumping, we need to generate population inversion, and thereby, this delta J, which is the extra intensity that you can get out of the medium, only under these conditions, if N2 is the number of the systems in high energy state exceed the ones in ground state, only under those conditions can this be positive. So we can get more intensity out of the medium. What are the typical features of laser light that we utilize in muscle research? First of all, it's high power, of course. It's a large spatial power density. The monochromaticity, which gives us the possibility of doing some very fun fluorescence investigations, and certain nonlinear effects, the second harmonic generation, the multi-photon effect. And this is what I want to spend a little bit on. Of course, high power is required, nearly a focal point of an optical trap is very important. So if you want to manipulate with lasers, we need to do that. The nonlinear effects can give us the possibility of accessing some structural information. So these nonlinear effects two very much related effects here, the two photon effect and the second harmonic generation. They are very much related because using a femto laser, that is a femtosecond laser, two photons arriving at a suitable local system are absorbed at once, and that will result in reaching an excited state. And upon relaxation from this excited state, we get the fluorescence phenomenon. Of course, in the case of two photon fluorescence, the probability of getting the two photon effect is high enough only in the focal point of the microscope, thereby you can limit the activated area. Second harmonic generation is very similar. In this case, a suitable system, the suitability of the system lies in its geometry mainly, in its molecular geometry. These two photons are again absorbed at the same time, and we obtain a frequency doubled doubled photon emitted by the system. So the wavelength is half and the energy enhancing the frequency is doubled. Now, under certain conditions, in a molecular system with a given symmetry, we can obtain second harmonic generated signal even from in vivo tissue. And it turns out that the myosin stick filament is particularly suitable for that. So that gives us a chance to reveal some structural information about muscle using second harmonic generation. So these are the non-central symmetric molecular systems, for example, chiral materials, which are actually suitable for second harmonic generation. And the myosin thick filament is such a system. So this is a fairly recently published structure of the myosin thick filament. This is from tarantula muscle. And this is a certain helical symmetry. This is within the shaft, like the tails of the myosin molecules. And in a helical pattern, we observe the head, the arrangement of the heads, the myosin heads. And this is actually the way we envision the myosin thick filaments to be present in most of the different striated muscle types. Now, so what happens if we illuminate a muscle, just a label-free, unlabeled muscle tissue? What happens if we illuminate it with a femto laser in a two-photon microscope? We obtain a second harmonic generated signal. In fact, so the excitation in this case was one micron of wavelength, and we obtain second harmonic generated signal called bubble, and these are purified myofibrils. And you can see that the A bands actually the ones that shine. So these are the parts of the sarcoid here, which actually carry the property of generating second harmonic signal. Now these are actually, again, you can look at the zeitgenome structure of the atomic force microscope, and this is a zeitgenome of mammalia, this is rabbit myosin molecules, which actually merge into this zeitgenome structure. These are the ones that carry the property of the second harmonic generation. Can this be utilized under in vivo, more sophisticated in vivo conditions? Now, in the introduction, I mentioned to you that even though we know quite a bit about muscle, or so we think, we still don't even know sarcomere distribution in vivo, particularly in different extension and flexion regime of the ranges of our various muscles. And just very recently, I came out a paper on such a in vivo sarcomere measurement by using the second harmonic generated second harmonic imaging, and in such a setting, this extensor carpi radialis radius muscle was exposed to this femtosecond laser pulses through this sort of green lens, and SAG signals were collected from it, and upon scanning, after scanning, these are the raw images that were collected, and from the repeat pattern, one can, and knowing that these bright regimes correspond to the A bands of the sarcomere, you know, one can calculate the sarcomere length by actually plotting the distance between the maximum. And from this, at least we can get to an idea of the extension and flexion range and the sarcomere length distribution between these two. So this is the complete flexion, okay, and this is the 45-degree extension of the wrist. And there's a range of sarcomeres measured. And for your guidance, this is the various parts of the sarcomere length force curve corresponding to the sliding current hypothesis. This is the so-called ascending limb of the sarcomere length force curve. This is the plateau region, and this is with the descending limb. Very interestingly, at the very end of this regime, you find sarcomere lengths even up to 3.7, 3.8 microns, which, to our current knowledge, is beyond the overlap. So, at this, in this regime, there's no overlap between the actin and myosin filaments, and most likely the elastic protein tactic must jump into action so as to maintain the contractility of the sarcomere. Okay, in the second half, the second part that I'd like to talk to you about is how we can manipulate with lasers. And I know that some lecturers have already been on this topic. Of course, it has been a dream of mankind to be able to manipulate with lasers. And this has come about in the Star Trek series, in the tractor beam, which are hypothesized to be able to capture and pull in even spaceships or on this chair. Now, in the 70s, Arthur Ashkin was the one who started developing the so-called optical tweezers, and this has developed into very sophisticated machinery and instrumentation, so much so that even atoms can be trapped and cooled to millikelvin or microkelvin temperatures. Using the same concept as optical tweezers, and for this trio obtained the Nobel Prize in 1997. So what are optical tweezers? In optical tweezers, the momentum change occurs between the photons and the refractile particle, and this is idealized setting. You see the light impinging light beam carrying this P1 momentum, and upon refraction, light We have a field of photons, which is a high intensity spot near the focal point. And near this focal point, do we find such a scenario of balance between the various optical forces, namely between the scalar force, which is essentially light pressure that is in parallel with the propagation of light, and the gradient force, which is proportional to the intensity gradient near its focal point, and it's corresponding to the momentum change because of diffraction. And the balance of between these two main types of forces results in the generation of a harmonic potential, which can actually capture refractile particles. And this is just a manifestation of that. These are 3 micron polystyrene beads captured in an optical trap. This is actually one bead captured in a trap. And as you can see, there is a hydrodynamic drag in the vicinity of this bead because these beads are carried forth by the solution flow. And despite this solution flow, keep this object trapped and captured in